I want to begin tonight by just telling you just briefly about my time last Sunday through Wednesday. Church I had only heard about because they come to our commit rally, the Coral Hill Church in Glasgow, Kentucky. Let me tell you what's so unique about them. 35 people, 12 song leaders. And they sing every song in the book. I don't care if it's an alto lead, a bass lead, doesn't matter. They sing them all. They meet before the time of assembly for 30 minutes and they sing. That's the singingest bunch for 35 people. Per capita, they put so many churches to shame. It's amazing how they sing. I was just totally blown away by those people. They are outstandingly good people. And they come to our rally. They enjoy it. And the youth minister at the Cumberland Parkway Church in Somerset, that's his home congregation. That's how I got to know him and them. So it's a good opportunity, good people, thoroughly enjoyed it. And I think sometimes I'm gone and I don't tell you where I am. So I usually like that, but this was something I wanted to tell you about this time. Turn to Proverbs 31, please. I want to take a few minutes and hopefully show you a powerful statement that, to be honest, I have never concentrated upon in this text. I've dealt with this text many times. You have too. It's a very popular text. I meant this morning to say something that I forgot to say, but I'll say it tonight. It is interesting to me, and it sort of fits the things that I want to speak about for a few minutes. It is interesting to me that there is no place in Scripture, anywhere, no place in Scripture where God takes this much time to praise a father. Nowhere. Doesn't exist. Now, I don't think that's because he thinks fathers aren't as good as mothers. No, I don't think that's it. I think there are some reasons that I could believe as to why, but it's interesting to me that in all of Scripture, when God concentrates his thoughts about one or the other, it's this text, and it's about a woman. Let me tell you a few things first before we get into the place that I want to read. I have to be honest with you, I get tired. I get tired of the mentality that anybody has, I don't care who it is, who is constantly thinking about all the things that I cannot do. I get tired of it. I mean, I cannot, even though I enjoy doing some woodworking, I cannot do the kind of work Tom Brown does. Can't do it. I mean, I couldn't even do it if I spent years studying under him. I can't do it. And I could really complain, and I could say, oh man, since I can't do that, then what good am I? Now you take your situation, whatever it is, doesn't matter. And you tell me, if you spent your entire time, or if the highlights or the lowlights of your life were you thinking about the things that you cannot do and bemoaning and being upset and being bothered by it, what kind of life would you have? Well, particularly, I think it's a great thing, obviously, to honor mothers. I love it. I think it's a great idea. I think we hope we never stop doing it. You know, if we lose our country to some dictator, I hope we can still honor mothers. I think it's important. But I have to tell you, there are times that I get really tired fighting the battles of women who bemoan what they cannot do. I get tired of it. Because you can do so much. And you do so much. And you are so valuable. And you have so much to offer. It's a lot like a childish attitude. A childish attitude. The childish attitude is, your child is at home and has this group of toys. And another child comes to visit. And all of a sudden, one of those toys is over there. Well, I'm not satisfied with these. I got to have that one too, right? Women have such a wonderful role to play in the kingdom of God. It cannot be overestimated. And don't worry, ladies. When it comes Father's Day, we're going to do the very same thing again. But in the midst of honoring and in the midst of praising, and I want to challenge you. And I want to challenge you to be satisfied being a woman. I know there are some people that seem not to be able to make up their mind what they are. Man, woman, I don't know. I learned pretty early on, it's pretty easy to tell. Pretty easy to tell. So, be proud of who you are. We can't do what you do. We can't be who you are. God made you for a reason. He gave you purpose. He gave you ability. He gave you talents. Be proud of who you are. And just because you don't have this or are not permitted this should not ruin your life. You got a bunch of toys, bunch of stuff. Think about this. Don't always be looking over there, but I wish I could or I wish I had. Because let me tell you how powerful you are. Here's the verse. The very last one and the very last phrase of Proverbs 31. The verse is, give her of the fruit of her hands. Now watch this. And let her own works praise her in the gates. You ever thought about what that means? You ever figured out, well, what's he trying to say? Let her own works praise her in the gates. Well, it seems to me that you really can't figure out what that means until you figure out what he means by the word gates. What's he talking about? Let me take you back without preaching the whole sermon again. Let me take you back to the story of Lot. You remember Lot? His uncle said, take whichever area you want to go to and I'll go somewhere else. And Lot looked over and saw the plains of Sodom and said, ooh, that's beautiful, I'll take it. And we see him looking in that direction. And before long, he's not just pitching his tent looking in that direction. Now he's living in the city. And by the time we get to chapter 19 of Genesis, he's standing at the gates. You know what the gates are in the Old Testament time period? It's the court system. All the business was held at the gates. All the covenants were made at the gates. All the laws were adjudicated at the gate. Because the city was there for people who lived out there. The walled city was there. And when there was trouble out there, they could run inside and be protected by the city. And so the gate to the city became the place where they did business and where they conducted all the affairs of the political system of whatever city or city state they happened to be. So when you see Lot in the gates of Sodom, Lot has become a leader. He's on the inside now. Now, we get upset thinking about Lot because look what he did. He moved to that terribly awful city. I know that, and I use that in a lesson. And I think that he did make some mistakes. But we have to remember that in the New Testament, Lot is praised by God. Because the Bible says he tormented his righteous soul by the deeds of that city. So why was he now in leadership in the city of Sodom? Maybe to make a difference. Maybe he got himself in a leadership position so he could change from the inside what was going on in the city. Maybe he could protect people, because when we first see him at the gates, what is he doing? He's protecting the two strangers who've come into the city. They happen to be angels from the Lord. He didn't know it, but he found out they were there and he took them immediately to his house. Why? He knew what was going to happen to them. Oh no, we'll just stay in the courtyard. No, you won't. And later when the men tried to tear down the house and get them to let them out, he said, I brought them under my roof for this very purpose. He was in the gates. Now, I want you to think about what this means in Proverbs 31, verse 31. This woman who was doing what she should do. She was proud. I think when I read this text, I can't see a woman who is thinking about all the things she can't do, all the things she's not permitted to do, all the talent she doesn't seem to have. Why, you get this and you get that. And she just constantly, that's not the woman of Proverbs 31. She has her hands, it says, to the distaff. In other words, she's involved. She's doing what she can do. Because when you do what you can do, you don't have time to think about what you can't do. You just don't. This woman is busy. She's a businesswoman. She has a great character and reputation. She takes care of her family. Everything about her is why we call her the virtuous woman. Listen to the point. Because her being proud to be a woman and living as God wanted her to live, all the men conducting business and politics in the gate of the city were praising her. Why did they praise her? Not because she was trying to be other than she was. They praised her because she was being who she should be. I remember Jerry Clower, one of my favorite comedians of all time. I saw him in person in a local high school. There's only about 100 of us there. Pretty cool event. And he said, it's about the time that the women's lib movement started. And some of you maybe read about it in history books, I don't know. But some of us have lived through it. You remember the women's lib? Shake your heads. You remember the women's lib movement? All this kind of stuff. And back then, you know what the big thing was? You remember what the big thing was? If the women's lib movement passes, we're going to be sharing bathrooms. Christian women rose up all over the country and knocked down that thing in so many ways. But here's what Jerry Clower said about the women's lib movement. He says, Mama, talking about his wife, Mama don't want nobody messing with the deal she's got. Said all she has to do is get up before 9 o'clock in the morning and let the maid in. And then she gets to go back to bed. And later on, that maid will have her lunch. And she and I'll eat dinner. Mama don't want nobody messing with the deal she's got. We got women messing with God's deal. You don't need to. Because when you do what God wants you to do, they praise you in the gates. You influence politicians. I forget, you'll tell me, because I can't remember her name. who was the woman who was running for president, I believe, trying to, and someone asked the question, what if your husband said he didn't want you to do this? She said, well, I would have to listen to him because I'm his wife, and I would have to take that into consideration. And they slammed her up one side and down the other. Why, you're a woman, you can do whatever you want to do. Her point was not that he was going to do this. Her point was, we're a team, but I'm fulfilling my role. You know why? Because that's what gets you praised in the gates. He says about this woman, she influences leadership. Because of living and being proud of being the woman she was, they were talking about her when they got together to conduct business and to set policy and to make law and to adjudicate how the laws are going to be handled in this case and that case. They were talking about her. I've even had some say when I ask, meet a couple for the first time, children, I say, well, what do you all do? He says, I do so and so. She says, I'm just a mom. Oh, no. No, stop that. You're not just a mom. You're mom. And I can't nobody do that but you. So as we close this day in honoring moms, I want you to be proud to be what God made you. And I want you to be satisfied to be where God put you. And I want you to be happy to do what you can do. And don't be talking about and belly aching over what you can't do or not allowed to do. It's not a matter of God saying to anybody, you can't do this and you can't do that. He's simply saying, be yourself. I made you for this purpose. This is who you are. Be this. So leave here today, moms and ladies who one day want to be mom. You leave here being proud that you have a role that cannot be duplicated. It cannot be improved. We're not improving. We have not improved the nature of women when we put them on the front lines of the military. We haven't helped them. We used to protect our women. Now we hire them to protect us. I'm not saying they can't do the job. I'm saying, I think more of them than that. Be who you are. And love it, because that's how God made you. Well, that's the lesson for all of us. Be who you are. I saw a sign just recently and used it in my lessons over the week. I don't remember who it was, saw it on the school sign. Be who you are. Because everybody else is taken. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Tonight, be who you are, made in the image of God, designed to live with God. Give your life to the Lord. Be a child of God. Be obedient. Just let go. Be submissive to His will in every way, including being baptized for the remission of your sins, in order that you might be ushered into the kingdom of God and be filled with His Spirit. Or rededicate and say, I'm going to change. I'm going to be better. I'm going to do more. I'm going to be me. Can we help you tonight? If you'll come as we stand and sing.